You see, we, as Paul did in his day, live in a culture where words are quite cheap. One of the things that people liked to do, the Greeks particularly liked to do, was just to debate things. I mean, nothing ever changed, they just debated things. It was fun, they enjoyed it. But that's not enough. There needs to be the release of divine power.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Not Just Words But Power, Thessalonians chapter 1 verses 1 to 10 by Pastor David Wise.
I'm going to be asking questions, so this is interactive. So there'll be questions, there'll be things for us to talk about together. We're starting a new series this morning, looking at 1 Thessalonians. It seems very strange being back in the New Testament, having been in the Old Testament since November 2007. But we're back in the New Testament for this series. We'll be working through the whole of Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians was probably the very first part of the New Testament to be written. If the books were arranged in order that they were written rather than the order they're in now, 1 Thessalonians would be right at the start. It was probably written less than 20 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. The context was this. We should have moved on a bit, shouldn't we? There we go. The context was this, that Paul and Silas and Timothy had been to Thessalonica to tell them about Jesus. They had been involved in preaching there and teaching there. And as a result, a new church was born. However, there was some very serious opposition to Paul. And as a result of that, he had to leave Thessalonica very suddenly and prematurely. And he was unable to return there. And so he sent Timothy to visit the young church. Remember that this church community that this letter was written to, most of these people have been Christians just a few months. I want you to get hold of that as we go into this book. This was written to people who'd only been Christians for a few months. So he sent Timothy back to visit the church because he wanted to know how things were going with the church, how things were working out. So he sent Timothy. Timothy met with the church and talked to them and came back and brought a report to Paul. And so in response to that news, Paul wrote to the church. Now, most of the letters that we have from Paul in the New Testament were written to churches to put them right on wrong doctrine, things that they'd misunderstood, things they'd got wrong, or where they were completely off the rails at times, doing outrageous things. Paul was writing to them to try and get them back on track. 1 Thessalonians is different from all of that because there are no big doctrinal corrections that Paul is writing about. He wrote this to encourage the young church. So are you ready to be encouraged? Don't sound too keen on that. Let's try that again. Are you ready to be encouraged?
Yes.
So we're going to be encouraged as we work through this quite short letter over the next few months. So we start today at the beginning, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 1. If you've got one of the church Bibles and you haven't managed to find it yet, it's on page 1186 that we are starting from. Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you. We always thank God for all of you, mentioning you in our prayers. We continually remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labour prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. It's an obvious thing to say, but it's there at the beginning. This letter was from a team. One of the things we notice when we look at the church in the New Testament, all over the place you see teams of people. You don't see an individual running a ministry or an individual. They always travelled with other people. They worked as a team. They came to Thessalonica as a team. They ministered there. And this letter is from the team that is there. Teams are important things. It's why in the church family here, we're all the time looking at creating teams of people that are doing things, teams working alongside people. And it's written to the church. Now, the word church that that Paul uses here, the Greek word for that, it's an interesting term because it was an word that was in everyday use. And it, what it meant was a gathering or an assembly of people. People that came together for some purpose. So let's just read it like that rather than church, because church, the word church has got a huge amount of baggage with it today. It's, you know, when you say to someone about what is a church, I mean, the first thing that comes to mind is bricks, mortar, steeple, stained glass windows. And if it's not that, it's an organisation. You know, whether it's the Baptist Union of Great Britain or the Anglican Communion or the Roman Catholic Church. But it had none of that in these days. The word church simply was the common word for a group of people that gathered together for a purpose. So it says, literally, to the gathering in God the Father of people in Thessalonica. So the people who are gathering in God the Father, who were in Thessalonica. I want us to pause with that for a moment. I'm not going to go through every single word in detail as we go through these 10 verses, but I want us to think about that for a moment. I mean, we have the name of Greenford Baptist Church. And that, you know, you use that to people and they think of a building that looks a bit like a warehouse from the outside. They might think of an organisation or a structure. But if we thought of ourselves as the people from this part of Greenford and slightly outside who gather together in God the Father, how would that change our attitudes to being church? If rather than thinking of it in structurally or in terms of a building, that it was a group of people, an assembly of people who this morning have gathered together in God the Father. That's the defining thing. That's what makes this group different to all the other groups that were in Thessalonica. There were loads of others, assemblies of people in Thessalonica doing all sorts of things. What made this group different and unique was that they met in God the Father. If we thought of ourselves like that, how would that change our perceptions? How does that challenge the way that we view meeting together, that we call church? It's a nice difficult question to start with. I want to stretch your thinking as we begin this morning. Is Matt?
Please, we are brothers and sisters, and what concerns my brother concerns me as well.
Okay, so it's because we are in God the Father, that means if we're in relationship with him, we therefore become brothers and sisters. So we have family concerns. And if you come from a culture like the one that you come from, where family is so important, if something concerns one part of the family, even if it's your second cousin twice removed, it's as though it's happening to you. So, okay, that's the first thing. Very good. What else? Belinda?
Also that we are not people working as a team and throwing our weight about and our powers about, but we're working through the power of God, that God is in the center of it all.
Okay, so we're actually first and foremost in God rather than anything else. So we're not here to get our own agenda, to make a noise for ourselves, or get a name for ourselves. It's because we're here first and foremost because we're in God. Liz?
Yeah, it's the same kind of thing. It's very hard to express, but there's a life source that no other group would have, because we're in the presence of God and sourced through him. So there is power and there is a dynamic that no other gathering of people.
Yeah, that's very good. There is a power and dynamic that no other group has. Because we're in God, it means that our origin is in God. It's nowhere else. Our origin is in God. It's not in an organization. It's not in a building. It's not in a history. It is in God. And if we are in God, it's like the vine image that Jesus used. There is all the life of God that flows through us. So we're sourced in him, origin is him, our life is in him. Yeah. Oh, that's exciting. We're only on the first verse. What else? Carol.
If we were more conscious of this, we might spend, find the time or more time in preparation before we came together. Because even though we're Christians, born again Christians, you can still behave in a fleshly manner.
Yeah. So spend time. I wonder if you had gone this morning to be with the Queen, if you'd had an invitation this morning at 10 o'clock to go to Buckingham Palace and be with the Queen, I wonder how long you would have put in preparation for that. Thinking about what you're going to wear, maybe you're going to buy in a hat, I don't know. Some of you might not be into hats. Whatever it might be, you put a lot of thinking into that, wouldn't you? A lot of preparation for that. Tell you, we are in the presence this morning. We are not just in the presence, we are in God the Father. We are in God the Father. How much preparation do you put when you come to be together with your brothers and sisters in God the Father? This isn't just turning up to some building and singing a few songs and having a nice cup of tea and a chat to a few people we know and maybe a few people we don't know and then going home again afterwards. It is about being together, rooted and sourced, our origin in God the Father. That's what makes this different. That's what makes us distinct from any other group not in God the Father that's meeting around anywhere today. What makes this different is that we are in God the Father. That's our origin. That's our source. That's our life. That's where we live out our lives together. Paul says that he always, continually remembered the Thessalonican assembly before our God and Father, their work produced by faith, their labor prompted by love, their endurance inspired by hope. As becomes clear later on in 1 Thessalonians, we'll see it as we work through. Paul was the father, and also he describes himself as the mother of the church. He uses both those images in Thessalonians to describe his relationship to the church. And those of you who are parents, you will know that whether your kids are living at home, whether they are 12, 20, 35, or even older, you keep thinking about them, don't you? They keep coming into your mind, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. They are constantly in your thoughts. And for Paul, this was the case for this group of which he was the father. They are constantly in his thoughts and prayers. He's continually taking them to God. I hope you're doing that, by the way, for your kids whenever they come into your mind, or your grown-up children, whenever they come into your mind, you lift them before God the Father, always, continually. And he was giving thanks for them all the time. Giving thanks for them. Giving thanks for what they had already achieved. Now, these people had only been Christians for months. And already, Paul is looking at their situation and seeing the work produced by faith, the labor prompted by love, and the endurance inspired by hope. They had got on with the work that God had called them to do. And as we'll see in a few verses' time, they'd endured a lot of persecution in that process. Their life had been really hard. In fact, their life before they became Christians was in many ways easier than their life when they gave their lives to God. It got more difficult for them because they were now persecuted. We'll come back to that in a few verses' time. It's really important to note that their faith resulted in action that could be seen. Now let's think about this for a moment. This assembly that is together in God, in Thessalonica, new Christians, and Paul is aware, and other people were aware, as we'll see in a few verses' time, of their work produced by faith, their labour prompted by love, their endurance inspired by hope. What do you think? You're going to have to imagine now, because the answer's not there on the page. You need to engage your imaginations. What do you imagine that labour, that work produced by faith, that labour prompted by love, that could be seen, looked like? What was it that Paul had seen, that Timothy had seen, and the people in the surrounding area had seen, as we'll come to in a few moments' time, in this young church made up of these new converts? What have they seen? What have people seen? What does it look like to see church in this way? What do you think? Dorothy?
They care for each other and look after each other.
Oh, caring for each other, looking after each other. Yeah, very good. What else? Fiona?
Talking about the change from where they were, because, you know, if they're enduring things already, there's obviously been a radical change. They've literally decided to split the more extreme change than we have in the Western world, and they've risked a lot to make that change.
Okay, so the fact they're being persecuted indicated that they were identifiable.
Yeah.
Because there'd been radical change
yeah.
in their lives. Any idea what some of those changes might have been? Do you want to speculate?
I don't know that much about Thessalonica, but probably there's money involved, and so it's rich people hanging out with poor people, which would just go against the cup.
Okay, so they're crossing barriers. So we've got slaves and free mixing together,
yeah.
people crossing ethnic barriers, maybe people eating together that in their own cultures wouldn't have been allowed even to be in the same house, sort of thing that's going on. What else? Come on, people. Engage your imaginations. Engage your imaginations. What's this about? Yes?
Being a very good example among the community and believers.
Okay, so what sort of things is, Matt, would be a good example? Come on, I'm trying to make it a bit more specific. So right after, but what sort of thing?
Showing God's love to others.
Showing God's love to others. How might that happen? So if you're a visitor, by the way, I don't always pick on people like that. Ismat's part of the leadership here, so I can keep going at him. He's up for that. Come on. What does that look like?
Show something practically to yeah. neighbour, and something in action.
Okay, something practically to a neighbour. So what they might have done for a neighbour?
Help them.
Go. Giving them some food.
Full support.
Welcomed them, supported them, cared for them, loved them, prayed for them, perhaps. Yeah, very good. Very good. Rangina?
Some of the people that probably were persecuted by their own family, their friends and people like that, and maybe they were homeless, the Christians would take them in.
Okay, so some of them, they would have been persecuted by family, without doubt. That's one of the things we'll see later in the book. So, giving hospitality, welcoming people into their homes, looking after people that have been thrown out, yeah. Okay, what else? Anything else? Yeah.
I think they endured despite the things happening around them. And for instance, like Mom Regina just said, that they might be persecuted by their own family, neglected, but they never gave up on.
Okay, so even though this whole endurance thing, even though people treated them badly,
yeah.
they actually stayed yeah. in God
yeah.
and more fervently in
yeah.
God. And that says something, doesn't it?
Yeah.
When somebody becomes a Christian and other people treat them really badly and they still go on loving God and serving God, that actually makes their message even louder, doesn't it? Even louder, yeah. Let's go on to verse 4. For we know, brothers loved by God, that he has chosen you because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit, and with deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake. I love this expression in verse 4. For we know, brothers, loved by God, that he has chosen you. So for brothers, read brothers and sisters. What an encouraging way to be described. Isn't that fantastic? And do you know something? Put your hand up if you're here this morning. Because this applies to you. And if you're watching this on the internet, it applies to you. Chosen by God. Loved by God. When you got up this morning, dragged yourself out of bed, or dragged out of bed by some child, "Mummy, it's time for breakfast," or whatever, I wonder if the first thought that went through your mind this morning is, "I'm chosen and loved by God." It might have changed how you got out of bed this morning. Let's be honest. It might have seemed a bit different. If when you woke up this morning, you remembered, one of the first things you remembered was not what you hadn't done the night before, but actually, "I'm chosen by God. I'm loved by God." You know, when you watch teenagers, some of you got teenage children, so you'll know how true this is. When one of them falls in love, don't laugh, when one of them falls in love, gets into, you know, a really good friendship and relationship, their whole mood changes, doesn't it? You know, they even do the washing up. Come on, is this not true? Is this not true? It changes the whole way that they are because they know that somebody actually loves them and cares about them. I mean, if the relationship breaks down, it's nightmare, absolute nightmare. We won't go there. But it actually changes how we feel, how we see the day when we know that somebody actually cares about us. There are so many people in our world that feels that nobody cares about them. Nobody would miss them if they died today. Here's the reality. God loves and cares about us. Loves and cares about you. Amen?
Amen.
So that should affect how you see things. So tomorrow morning, when you get up to go to work or college or whatever it is, or if you're working nights, tomorrow afternoon when you get up or whenever it is, remember this. God loves and cares for you. And you are chosen by God, who made the whole of the universe. You know, in that song, Indescribable, that we sing, the entire universe, all that stuff that God has made, and yet, I could go round and name you individually. I'm not going to do that. We haven't got time to do that. But each one of you, loved by God, chosen by God. Why don't you say that to yourself? Stick your name in there for a moment. And say it. Just say it out loud together. Well, just say it out loud. That Ismat is chosen and loved by God. Just say it about yourself. Use your own name. David, loved and chosen by God. Oh, isn't that fantastic? Creator, sustainer of the universe. Loves and chosen you. I don't understand his choice. I don't mean that about you, but I mean that about me, of course. Don't understand why, but that is the reality. God loved and chosen you. Because our gospel, says Paul, came not only with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit, and with deep conviction. In these couple of verses here, there are four aspects of the gospel. Now, we are in the process of preparing for a major outreach, which we'll be doing in just a few weeks' time in the run-up to Easter, over Easter, and just the other side of Easter. So I'm going to spend a few minutes looking here at this definition, these aspects of the gospel that are here, because we need to be seeing all of these in our individual and corporate life, all of the time, but particularly over this next month, 6 weeks or so. The first one that's listed here is words. I know it's a bit trendy to say sometimes, you know, this quote, this phrase about communicate the gospel by all means, use words if you have to. But actually, words are really important in communicating the gospel. The good news that God loves us. The good news that Jesus' death and resurrection have made it possible for people to have a genuine relationship with God, the creator and sustainer of the whole of the universe, needs to be spoken out, needs to be shouted out. We need to be telling people. People around us. Saying it out to people. But words alone are not enough. The second thing here is power. Divine power. You see, we, as Paul did in his day, live in a culture where words are quite cheap. One of the things that people like to do, the Greeks particularly like to do, was just to debate things. I mean, nothing ever changed. They just debated things. It was fun. They enjoyed it. But that's not enough. There needs to be the release of divine power. And one of the aspects of that, and it's only one, is the whole area of healing. Which is why, as a part of this mission, we are running two training sessions, which are going to be on the, where are we? The 28th, no, I'm sitting here somewhere, 11th of March and the 25th of March, called Seeing Healing on the Streets of Greenford. Because we want to see people encouraged, mandated, and released to see God's divine power flowing through people. So that as you meet people on the doorstep, or as we're doing in that some of the street work that we're going to be doing, it's not just about communicating with words, but that you have the confidence to be praying for people and seeing God's power released through you and seeing people made whole, physically, emotionally, spiritually. Amen? Amen?
Amen?
I was talking this week to Christian Forster, who's the guy that's coming with a team to lead these two sessions. They're not repeats. They are part one and part two, so you need to be at both. They're not alternatives. The briefing sessions for the mission are alternatives. They're the same. But this training session, Healing in the Streets of Greenford, is part one and part two. And our aim is to see, at the end of that second evening, every single person commissioned and mandated and anointed by God to see God's power released through them as they talk to people on the streets. That's what we're about. Yes, there will be Bible teaching, but also there will be prayer ministry, and we'll be praying for an impartation and release of God's anointing upon us. Not for ourselves. We have too much healing in church. What I mean is we've got the focus in the wrong place. I do believe that God heals people, and we pray for people in church, we see people healed. But the most of the healing you see in the New Testament is not in the gathered assembly. It's outside. And healing is one of those evangelistic tools that we see in the New Testament. And I don't think God's methods have changed. Do you?
No.
Our God is still the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
People still have the same needs. So we want to see that power released. So we want to see the words. We want to see the divine power being released. And we recognize the third component of this is the Holy Spirit. You see, it's not our words that see people become Christians. Our words are important. But actually, it's the work of the Holy Spirit inside of people that sees people come to faith. And that's really important. Which is why, as a part of this mission, we have got so many prayer meetings. Some in the evening, some in the morning, other ones as well. We want people, there's going to be another week of prayer that's not on this sheet because you're going to be doing it, you're not going to be coming together to do it, You're going to be doing it each day on your own. We're going to give you a sheet with the day and the subject for the day in the week running up to the week we're meeting to pray together. So every day we'll all be praying around the same topics and themes. Why are we doing that? Because we are utterly, totally dependent on God. Not on our cleverness, not on our slick publicity, not on our organisation and planning. We are utterly, totally, completely dependent on God. And prayer is about demonstrating that dependence on God and hooking into God and seeing the Holy Spirit released. We want to see God's Spirit released on the streets of Greenford and the parts of North Holt that we're going to visit and the bit of Hayes that we're going to visit, because the border's just down the road here, the areas that we're focusing on. We want to see God's Spirit released. Amen?
Amen.
And to do that, we need to be praying. Words, divine power, Holy Spirit, and deep conviction. And that deep conviction is actually on the part of the people that are doing the evangelizing. You see, sometimes people that have been, particularly I think people that have been Christians for a long time, one of the things I notice is that when somebody first become a Christian, they are passionate in telling everybody around them about Jesus. I mean, sometimes inappropriately, sometimes in the wrong places, but they're absolutely passionate about it, wherever they are, yeah? But when people have been Christians for a long time, they're not so passionate, I've noticed, often. There are some that are, but there are others that aren't. Why is that? Well, they've forgotten the change that comes about when people become Christians. They've forgotten what it's like not to know God. You know, someone like me, I've been a Christian. This year, I will have been a Christian for 40 years. It's a struggle for me to remember back what it was like before I became a Christian. I've known God for so much of my life. And so I can forget what it's like for people that don't know God, who are going to an eternity not knowing God. I know where I'm going when I die, as do most of you, if not all of you. We're going to heaven. We're going to be with God. It's going to be fantastic. But the people that don't know him are not going there. And we need that deep conviction. Again, this comes through our prayer as we engage with God. We need that deep conviction, some of us, again, about the power of the message that we have and the need that people around us have to hear that message of God's love for them, of God's care for them. So the deep conviction needs to be there. Let's just pause for a moment. If you've not filled in one of these sheets yet, could you just put your hand up? If you've not filled in one of these sheets yet and returned one of these sheets, could you just put your hand up? We're about to give you one. So just put your hand up. If you've not filled in a return, an Easter outreach count me in sheet. And you're not a visitor. If you're a visitor today, you don't need to do this. But if you're regular, just... Jibs, Warren's asking you to help him. Just to help you along there. Some at the back, some at the front. Over here. Come on, Jibs. Rush about, my friend. Okay, some people here. You've got one? Okay. I'd like to encourage you right now to take a pen. If you haven't got one, ask the people around you. Bound to be somebody with a pen. Because if what I'm saying is true, and most of you who've just taken a form here have said amen to this, you ought to be signed up to this. We want to see the overwhelming bulk of people who are part of this church family out telling others about Jesus. These new converts were doing it. They'd only been Christians for a few months, and they're out telling people about Jesus. You should be out telling people about Jesus. If you've never done door-to-door stuff before, Don't be anxious about it. We'll pair you with somebody that really knows what they're doing, so you're with somebody that's really confident, and then you can find confidence yourself in doing that. So sign up, doing door-to-door. Sign up that you're coming to these two training sessions on seeing God's healing released on the streets of Greenford. Sign up for these prayer meetings. And before you leave today, give the form back to me. I'll be in the foyer. So make sure these forms are filled in and done. This is exciting stuff. We want you in it. We want you a part of it. God's chosen you. God wants you to be going out. The expectation is very clear in Thessalonians. So these new converts, if they've received the gospel, they should be sharing the gospel. If they've been evangelized, they should be evangelizing. Because we've got good news to tell. And we'll be utterly selfish to keep it to ourselves. Because God's power has changed and transformed our lives. Amen?
Amen.
We need to be sharing with other people. So, verse 6. You became imitators of us and of the Lord. In spite of severe suffering, you welcomed the message with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it. The word imitation that we use in English has got a meaning that is not there in the words that are there in the original here. When we talk about imitation, we often mean something that's not the real thing. You know, this is an imitation watch. Rolex, that's it. This is an imitation Rolex. We mean it's not a real Rolex, it's an imitation Rolex. That isn't what is being meant here. This actually is different. In the way that, you know, the label that we have is Christians. Yeah? Christian means, it's come from the Greek language the New Testament was written in, Christian means little Christ. It's the diminutive form of Christ, Christian, little Christ. And a little Christ should be an imitation, a model of the real Christ. So you should be imitating, in the sense of really being like Jesus, like Christ. A model. Model does two things. You can look at a model, and a model is an example of something. But the other aspect of model, it's a way of doing things. It's an influence as well. It says here about them that they're, the news about them, the Lord's message rang out from you. The word rang out there, the word, that the Greek word that underlies that, is the word that we get echo from. The whole idea of ringing out. You know, when you ring bells really loud, the noise resounds all around. It bounces off other buildings. It bounces off other structures. It goes out all the way along the area. Yeah? It echoes around. And it says, these new Christians, you became a model. You were imitating. And God's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, everywhere. People are talking about God's message, the Lord's message. And this is a part of evangelism. And this isn't about us as individuals. This is about us as a community. This is about God's people then, and I believe God's people now, making a noise in the wider community, being known for serving God, for making a difference, for our faith to be known, our mission statement. Says this, to make God's love known to all in our area through caring and service, expressing our cultural diversity and challenging injustice. In our strategic objectives that we are working on for the next couple of years, the leadership team's strategic objectives, which we'll be presenting to the members' meeting in April. One of the things there is about us being known, having a high positive profile in the community, known for our love of God. Amen? Do you think that should be true of us? You think it should? Here's the question. What should people be seeing and hearing about us that brings honour and glory to God? What should it be that people are seeing? It's got to be something that people can see. What should people be saying when they talk about Greenford Baptist Church, the name that we're known around here? What should be people saying about us?
We care. We love our neighbours and people around the community.
Okay, so we're known for loving our neighbours, for caring for our neighbours, others in the community. Things like the Christmas Day meal, where we invite people who'd otherwise be on their own to come and spend the day with us, they're guests. We feed them, we entertain them, pick them up, take them home, give them gifts, that sort of thing. Yeah, what else?
Just the mere fact that we believe in God and Jesus.
We believe in God and Jesus. How would people see that, do you think?
Well, that we're here worshiping for a start.
Okay.
There's only a small percentage of people in Britain go to church on Sunday. They're all at the supermarket.
Yeah, they go to their church supermarket. Yeah, okay. What else? Come on, there should be tons of stuff here. Sorry, Jane.
That we speak out for people who haven't got a voice of their own.
We speak out for people who haven't got a voice of their own because God is passionate for justice. We should be passionate for justice for people. Local people, people in our nation, and people internationally. Belinda.
I was going to say we shout about it.
We shout about it. What do we shout?
That the love of Jesus and how he loves us and what he does in our lives. We let people know about it. So.
Okay, you're also part of the leadership here, so I'm going to push you a bit more on this. So, okay, we're talking here about people speaking out. Where should we be speaking out, Belinda? Let's make it personal. Where should you be speaking out?
Up there where I work, people I meet.
Okay, so in your work context, yeah. Where else do you go?
Supermarket.
In the supermarket?
Tesco's.
In Tesco's. Do you tell people in Tesco's about Jesus?
I do try.
Excellent, okay. What about your neighbours?
My neighbours, yes.
Telling them about Jesus?
Telling them about
Jesus. Got any family?
Inviting them, yes. My family, but some of my family are Muslims.
Okay.
I'm working on that as well.
So you're telling them about Jesus?
Yes.
Okay. Got any friends?
Yes, I do.
Okay, do you tell your friends about Jesus?
My friends about Jesus.
Anybody else I've missed in your network? So we've got family, friends, work colleagues, the places that you go.
You've got them all covered. Oh, even at parties when we're raving and boogie-woogieing. Yeah.
Boogie-woogieing at parties. Okay, we boogie-woogie for Jesus at parties. Okay. And Belinda, do you think that should be true for every person who is here?
Yeah. Very, very much so, yes. We should all come out of our comfort zone.
Okay.
I know I'm a bit too lively than should be, and I apologize for that, but I think we should all step out of our comfort zone.
We should all step out of our comfort zones. So if doing door-to-door is a bit uncomfortable for people, they ought to be stepping out and doing that. Yeah, they ought to be stepping out and doing it, whatever. Okay, and being involved in all the other stuff that we're doing as well. Okay, what else? Fiona.
United in the church, so that we are a united family. So even though families don't get on 100%, we appear to get on and we get over our differences. And that reflects God's character and makes us attractive to those that don't know God.
Okay, I think that's really important because it is true, isn't it, in families, because we don't choose our families. And so there are always people in families that don't get on too well together. Yeah. Certainly my family, I mean, I'm sure it's true in others as well. And in our church family, we haven't chosen our church family. True. So there are people in our church family, particularly a church that's got, as this one, somewhere around 300-400 people who come here at least twice a month to one of our meetings here. There'll be people we get on with and people we don't get on with. And it's how we deal with those people that we don't get on with, whether we actually still work and want the best for them,
yeah,
and love them and care for them, that actually people talk about.
Yes.
Yeah, very good, very good. Lorraine.
Yeah, just following on from what Jane said earlier,
we should be more concerned about issues in our local community.
Okay, concerned about issues in our local community. What sort of issues? Again, you're part of the leadership, so I'm going to push you. What sort of issues?
Where there's perhaps injustice.
Okay, what sort of injustice issues? Because, you see, the reason I'm doing this is, you see, it's all very well to make these big general statements, but we've got to root it in everyday things that we're involved with. Otherwise, it's just, you know, it's like listening to some politicians. I mean, I'm not against politicians, as most of you will know, but sometimes you get a politician's speech, all these great big statements. I'm sorry, I nearly knocked your head off then. All these great big statements, but actually you listen to it and think, well, actually, what on earth were they talking about? So what sort of issues? Let's name a few that you think we should... Christians should be getting involved with.
Right. But one example that comes to mind is there's been a document produced recently by CARE.
Okay.
Which touches on the relationships we should have, parents should have with children, teachers should have with parents and that. And then I think as Christians we should be influencing that to ensure that...
Okay, so the whole issue of schools. So we should be involved in schools and what's going on in schools, maybe being involved some with school governors... getting involved in lots of different ways in schools, educations, getting involved in politics. There's a government consultation, and email. We've sent an email out to a lot of people in church saying, you should read this, you should respond to this. Okay, very good. Anything else? Wayne? My, you're a long way away.
Sorry about that. Short legs. using our personal experiences, which may have been traumatic, and... how Jesus and God has helped us to turn our lives around. As we know, Paul was the biggest persecutor of Christians, and Jesus turned his life around. I myself was in the dark and seen the light through Jesus. So that would be one of my own personal actions that could be seen by.
So talking about the change and transformation, I mean, most people here would know that your life has, 180 degree turn from where it was. And that has, talking about that and being upfront about that, saying this is what it was before Jesus impacted my life, changed me, turned me around.
Divine power.
God's power. Yeah, very good. Very good. A lady.
Not really an answer, but I just want to testify to, in the course of my duty in cancer research, and I got talking with one of the elderly lady about Christ, and then she asked me, what church do you go to? I said, Greenford Baptist Church. And she said, oh, it's a church that does wonderful things for the elderly. So I think it is...
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. People in the community, one of the things for the elderly. And you may recall, I talked in testimony the other week about the fact that we were asked, because we were, as a church, were asked to make a submission to the second phase of the Stephen Lawrence inquiry, with all this stuff for the 10 years since the... publication of that report, we were one of the places contacted by The Guardian. In fact, I think we were the only church group contacted by The Guardian and asked about how we see things in terms of racial justice, because we made a submission to that that was very critical of the police at the time, how we see things now. So it's being known for that. I saw another hand over here. Yeah. I was going to ask Frank, actually, because, yeah.
I was going to say, I think we're a church that reflects the multicultural society we're in here. We're not just a white Western church that we used to be. We've moved forward, we recognise that, we value that.
Yeah, and we get on to, this is back to this thing about, we don't choose our family. And so we have people with people with quite different cultures, and those cultures clash sometimes. Some of the ways that some cultures do things and whether other cultures do things, they clash. But actually what we're learning to do here is we don't have to like what one another does, but actually at times we can really appreciate it. Sometimes we can learn from it. Sometimes we can just appreciate that and think, actually, that isn't for me, but that's great. Great that they're doing that. And in a society that actually in some ways is becoming a bit more fragmented, with the pressures of the economy and so on, people blaming one another and some of the demonstrations that we've seen, we need to be saying, well, actually, there is only one race, the human race. We're all different as a part of that. We're richer because we're together. And talking about that. Now, for them, it talks about here in the text, it talks about severe suffering. Not a little bit of being uncomfortable, but Paul talks about severe suffering. And for them, being a Christian was not easy. And for us at times, being a Christian is not easy. They suffered because of their faith. But their suffering added to the power of the message because people could see even more of Jesus. So last two verses we're going to look at today, verse 9 and 10. They tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God. And to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he has raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. Becoming a Christian, as it's defined here, is about turning from whatever idols are at the center of someone's life and turning to God. So it's about the displacement of whatever it is that's at the center of lives, turning from that. And for idols, of course, we can, in our context today, put all sorts of stuff in that. It might be about self, it might be about money, it might be about all sorts of other things, not just about little statues, but all sorts of idols. Turning from those things that are at the center of someone's life and turning to God. And all of that in the context of the fact that Jesus is coming back. Jesus who rescues us from the coming wrath, which is a phrase that was used for God's judgment. I was in a seminar this week, which some of you were at, was talking about the parable of the talents. How the fact that in the story, the master, before he went away on a journey, gave people talents. One gave one talent, another five, another ten. The whole context was that he was coming back to see what they'd done with the talents. And two of those people heard, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." One heard, "You lazy, wicked servant." And he was thrown out. There is coming for all of us judgment, Christian or non-Christian. We'll be judged for how we live our lives. That's very clear in Scripture. It's on a different basis if you're in God, in Jesus, if you're not. But judgment is coming. And human beings all need rescuing from God's judgment. And we're rescued from that by our faith in Jesus, from that coming wrath that will be revealed in due course. Let's begin to pull some of these things together. Our time has nearly gone this morning. What do we learn? What are the key things as we've started, as we've begun this letter this morning? We've done sort of like the overture, the introduction to the book. What are the key things that we take away from this morning? What are the key things that you as an individual take away from this morning, into this week, into this month? What are the key things that you take away?
I think just having hope that there's a better life beyond this life on where we are now, and that because of Jesus, we're going to be with him again and we're going to see him again. And he uses us at this moment to reach out to other people, the message.
Okay, that hope is really important. I didn't pull that out earlier on, but we're surrounded by people for whom there is no hope. Life for them is hopeless. And actually, in God, we have hope. And in the same way that being chosen by God, loved by God, transforms, actually having hope, hope not meaning some wistful longing for something in the future, but actually an assured knowledge that Jesus is coming. We're going to be with him. So, yeah, very good. Fiona.
You've been chosen and placed in a family, so you belong. There's a sense of belonging that maybe you feel like you were never picked for anything, you're always the last one picked for the team. Well, you specifically have been chosen. Yeah. Only you can fulfil the role that you've been chosen for, and you're a part of the family.
So we've been chosen. We've been picked to be in this family. And so many people go through life feeling that, you know, they're feeling rejected, they're feeling that, you know, other people always get it, but actually we've been chosen. Sarah.
We have to preach Jesus or tell other people about Jesus Christ.
Yeah, we have to tell people, other people about Jesus all the time, in all those contexts, in all those contexts that Belinda listed out. You want another go, Fiona?
Words aren't wasted.
Words are not wasted. Very good. Wayne.
Yeah, we are chosen. I, Wayne, am chosen and loved by God.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Wow. That's a statement, isn't it?
Sure.
That is a statement. And if you have the opportunity to hear Wayne's testimony, you will know that is a statement. Chosen and loved by God. Yeah. Is Matt?
When I come to church, I come to my to see my family, because the church is the gathering of people for the purpose of the Father.
Mm. Okay, so this is family. So we gather together in God. So when we come to see family, but also we come in God the Father. Yeah. Okay, these were the key things for me as I thought about this. Our faith should result in action that can be seen. Our gospel communication, it involves words, divine power, the Holy Spirit, deep conviction. And we as a church, Greenford Baptist Church, should be known in the local community for our service of God. I'd like to pray for you as we finish this morning. Let's stand together. I'm going to take a moment, as always when I do this, a few moments. I'm going to stop talking, so you have the opportunity to make a response to God, and then I'm going to pray for us together. Let's take a few moments in quiet. Father God, I want to thank you for the amazing fact that we are chosen by you. For that awesome, amazing fact that we are loved by you. Thank you for the fact that we are here this morning, chosen and loved by you in God the Father, that we're here this morning in your presence. Father God, thank you. Thank you. But Father, we recognize that also, that amazing choice, that amazing love also gives us responsibility to tell other people about you, to share that news with other people. And so, Father God, I ask that you will help us, every one of us, this week, whether we're at work, at home, with our neighbours, in the supermarket, college, wherever it is we find ourselves this week, to be telling other people about Jesus, about the amazing fact that you love them, about the amazing fact that you want to have a relationship with them, about the amazing fact that you've got purpose for their lives, hope for the future and for the present. Father God, help us to be doing that with power this week, with your Spirit this week, with deep conviction this week, as we speak your words. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.